Get ready for the wave. It might strike like a final flood. The people haven't drank in so long. The water won't even make mud. After it comes, it might come with a steady flow. Grab the roots of the tree down by the river. Dip your cup when your spirit's low. Clap your hands now. Dip, 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 dip down and take a drink and fill your water tank. Dip, dip down and take a drink and fill your. Dip, dip, dip down and take a drink and fill your water tank. Dip down, take a drink and fill your.
Hi, welcome to our new documentary series, Home. In this episode, we'll be exploring invasive species and how they impact on local ecosystems.
Home is an informative environmental science series focused on environmental issues happening right now across the globe. In this first episode, we'll be looking at several unwanted, non-native species that have taken up residence here in the Southwest. We'll speak to experts in their field with first-time experience of the species and find out what the UK is doing to manage these threats to native plants and animals. Invasive species don't fit into the existing ecosystem. They force themselves in, sometimes exploiting native species that aren't equipped to deal with them. This grey seal was caught snacking on a conger eel in Plymouth Sound. It's incredible species like this that often get the limelight, but frequently it's the less spectacular species that are pivotal for the health of our ecosystems. One such example is the unremarkable water vole. These UK rodents are vital prey for many UK predators. They are actually now facing extinction due to the invasive American mink. We've sent Josh to find out more.
The American mink was brought to the United Kingdom for fur farming in the early 20th century, but escaped and established wild populations due to deliberate releases and captive breeding escapes.
The mink is an opportunistic hunter and will attack even pike and adult swans given a chance. It is responsible for the near extinction of the water vole in the United Kingdom. I spoke to Tegan Hill of Westland Countryside Stewards and Martin Ketcher from Hearts and Middlesex Wildlife Trust to investigate.
It has a devastating impact on the native wildlife. It will go for fish, birds, hares, water voles, and it can completely devastate them.
As far as water voles are concerned, because it's been dramatic and catastrophic. The water voles have got plenty of natural predators. Water voles have got a mechanism to escape from all of those native predators. There is no means of escape for the water vole from the mink, but it can move up the river and take out every single water vole as it goes. So the impact has been pretty dramatic. We provide, technically alone, for mink rafts, for detecting and then trapping mink, to really whoever wants them. So it could be landowners, it could be individuals who've got a garden that backs down onto a river, it could be fishing clubs, gamekeepers, farmers, anybody. If they detect mink on the clay, they'll put a trap in and hopefully we'll capture the mink and dispatch it.
Capture them with a live capture trap so that we don't kill anything else in the meantime. Then it's humanely shot, viewed as a black spot for mink, which it's now mink free and water voles are thriving.
Another invasive species which shares the waterway with the American mink is the American signal crayfish. This invasive species is wreaking havoc among the locals.
The American signal crayfish is a large crustacean which inhabits waterways such as canals and rivers. It is larger than our native crayfish, the white-clawed crayfish, and has been linked to its decline. I've gone to meet conservationist Andrew Whitehouse from the conservation charity Bug Life in order to find out what is really going on.
What the North American signal crayfish, which is the main non-native species affecting our native crayfish, does is it outcompetes our crayfish, so it competes for habitat and it competes for food, and it also predates upon our crayfish. And the North American crayfish, the signal crayfish, can grow a lot quicker, they produce more offspring and they grow a lot bigger. What they also do is they can carry a disease, they're a vector for a disease called crayfish plague. This doesn't affect the signal crayfish, but it kills our native crayfish. So they're out-competing our native crayfish, and they're carrying a disease which is deadly to them. So it's a bit like grey squirrels and red squirrels. Well, I believe that the extinction of a species is something we should try and avoid. And let's not forget that the situation we find ourselves in with signal crayfish in the UK is entirely man-made. These are crayfish which were brought over here from North America for aquaculture. They've escaped from fish farms and aquaculture units, and they have spread through the countryside. So the potential extinction of white claw crayfish in the UK is in our making. You know, we've done this, so we should sort it out.
So far, we've seen two species of animal causing big problems for native species. However, with the water vole bouncing back and the fight against signal crayfish underway, the future looks hopeful. In the second part of this episode, we look at non-native plants causing just as many problems.
Another invasive species which is creating huge problems in the southwest is the Japanese knotweed. This invasive weed is actually listed one of the world's 100 worst invasive species.
As the Japanese knotweed has no natural enemies in the UK to prevent its growth, this has only made it harder to control. Whereas in native Asia, it is controlled by fungus and insects. To find out more, we decided to interview Paul Lunt, a lecturer at Plymouth University who has studied this invasive species.
In terms of why it's a problem for native species, well, its litter is described as being allelopathic, which means that it's got chemicals in it which kill off other plants, so other plants don't germinate in it. And because it's an exotic plant, so it's from Japan originally, it doesn't have many pests, so invertebrates don't tend to consume its leaves and buds and flowers. That's an interesting question, actually, because it is part. No way we would control all of it. So it is part of our ecosystem. Over time, of course, species will adapt to feed on the Japanese knotweed, and there's some signs that that's happening already. But that takes many generations of invertebrates and many decades, or if not hundreds of years, before you get the same kind of diversity on an introduced plant as you would on a native species.
Himalayan balsam was brought to the United Kingdom around the same time as Japanese knotweed. Intentionally brought to the United Kingdom as a flowering garden plant, it wasn't long before it escaped into the wild and became problematic. Himalayan balsam is the largest annual plant in Britain, growing up to 2.5 metres in a single season. It spreads quickly, projecting its seeds up to 4 metres. It produces a lot of pollen too over a prolonged season and is attractive to pollinating insects. It also blocks light from smaller plants. This presents a significant challenge to native species.
We spoke to Owen Smith from Plymouth University, whose PhD is on the Himalayan balsam.
And they have an effect on the number of pollinators, because they attract pollinators away from other plants. So there's a possibility they might be affecting the number of seeds that are produced in other plants. And they definitely have an effect on invertebrate numbers. So above and below ground invertebrates are affected by the presence of Himalayan balsam. It's not as big a problem as, say, weeds like Japanese knotweed, because it's an annual, so that you'll have temporal and spatial changes. So patches will appear and disappear according to changes in the environment. Maybe a scouring of a river will wash a whole load away. The seed will be transported further downstream. So it's not a permanent change. Eventually it will become reduced in its vigour, and so it will become just a kind of an average component of the ecosystem. That's my belief anyway.
We hope you have learned something from this documentary and are aware about the invasive species impacting the UK, persevering to help keep the environment safe from invasion.
We met the hard-working individuals that are tasked with driving these invaders out, and their efforts should ensure that the southwest returns to its natural equilibrium.
And that wraps up this week's episode, guys. Next week, stay tuned, we'll be looking at the effect of the palm oil industry on the Malaysian rainforests.